Hello students, welcome to EPG Parthshala. I am Dr. Shruti Thakur from University of Delhi. Today we are going to talk on module Measurement of Time under the paper Astronomy and Astrophysics. After studying this module, you should be able to define time, grasp the fact that time measurement is tied to the rotation of the Earth, appreciate that the solar day is not a constant quantity, explain what factor affects the length of the solar day. You should able to understand the need to define a fictitious object called the mean sun from which mean solar time is derived. Deduce from the equation of time the difference between the mean solar time and the apparent solar time. The concept of time is basic to the whole of science, indeed to the whole of knowledge. We intuitively know what time and its passage mean. For a formal definition, consider a point moving relative to a frame of reference. With each point on the point, we can associate a number which defines time. The passage of time is measured in terms of motion of the point relative to the frame of reference. The motion of the Earth relative to the Sun and stars form the basis of the various systems of measurement of time. It must be remembered that all our watches, clocks and other time measuring devices are tied to the daily and annual motion of the Earth relative to the Sun and stars. We discuss below how a measure of time is derived from these motions of the Earth. Rotating Earth is our natural clock. One rotation makes a day. One revolution around the Sun makes 1 year. The revolution of Moon around Earth approximately makes a month. We have seen in the previous module that the sun has a daily motion because of which it rises and sets. Daily motion is called as the diurnal motion and the path followed is called as the diurnal circles. The sun also has annual motion and the path followed by sun during its annual motion is called ecliptic. In this picture, the celestial sphere, the equator and the ecliptic are shown. The diurnal circles of Sun on 21st of June and 23rd of December are also shown. Its diurnal circles around 21st of June is in the northern hemisphere, while the diurnal circles around 23rd of December is in the southern hemisphere. On the other days, its diurnal circles are between these two extremes. Around 21st March and 23rd September, the diurnal circles of the Sun are in the plane of the celestial equator. From 21st of June to 23rd of December, the diurnal circles of the Sun migrate southwards, while from 23rd of December to 21st of June, the diurnal circles drift towards north. The drift is along with the position of Sun on the ecliptic. For 6 months, the diurnal circles are north of the equator. For 6 months, the diurnal circles are north of the equator and for remaining 6 months, the diurnal circles are south of the equator. Variation in the altitude of the sun. In this picture, horizon of observer is drawn. The observer is in the northern hemisphere. The diurnal circles of the sun are also shown. All the diurnal circles of sun lie between the diurnal circles of summer solstice and winter solstice. From the picture it is clear that for those living in the northern hemisphere, the sun is high in the sky around 21st of June. It is the summer time in the northern hemisphere. Around 23rd of December, the sun is lowest in the sky. Therefore, the sun above the horizon is for short time. It is the winter time in the northern hemisphere. In the southern hemisphere, the situation is exactly the opposite. The sun is high in the sky in December and low in sky in June. A consequence of the fact that the Earth rotates on its axis is the cycle of seasons. The rotation axis of Earth makes an angle of 23.5 degrees with its orbit. This axis of Earth remains constant in space. We have learned in classical mechanics that it is due to the conservation of angular momentum of the Earth. As a result of the tilt in the axis of Earth, for a part of the year,
The northern hemisphere receives more heat from the sun than the southern hemisphere. More heat is received by northern hemisphere when the earth is on the left of sun in the picture. Because of the tilt in the axis of earth, the northern hemisphere is oriented towards the sun. There is a corresponding increase in solar radiation as the sun's rays are striking this part of earth directly. Because of the same tilt, southern hemisphere is oriented away from sun and the rays that fall are not direct, hence there is a lesser amount of solar radiation falling in the southern part. It's winter in the southern hemisphere. The situation reverses after 6 months when the southern hemisphere is oriented towards the sun. Earth's orbit around sun is not circular but is elliptical. Sun is at one of the foci as shown in the picture. The farthest point from the focus on the elliptical orbit is called as aphelion and the nearest point is called as perihelion. Kepler's three laws of planetary motion are as follows. According to Kepler's first law, the annual path of the Earth around the Sun is an ellipse and not circular. According to the second law of Kepler, the area traced out per unit time by the line joining the Earth and Sun is constant. In the picture, the two arcs of orbit are shown, one around the perihelion and the other around the aphelion. The area swept by those arcs are also shown. The area of both these regions are equal. Therefore, according to Kepler's second law, the area swept per unit time has to be constant. This implies that the time taken by Earth to cover those arcs should be same. This is possible if the Earth traversed the arc around perihelion faster than the arc around aphelion. This implies that the Earth moves faster near the perihelion, which is the nearest point to the Sun, than near the aphelion, which is the farthest point to the Sun. Faster motion of Earth causes change in length of day. This is one of the causes of variation in the length of a solar day. We know that the Earth's equator and the ecliptic are at an angle. This obliquity of ecliptic is the second cause of variation in the length of day. These two planes, the ecliptic and the Earth's equator, are parallel only at equinoxes. The position of Sun that we observe is actually the projection of Sun's position in the ecliptic plane onto the equatorial plane. The sun moves along the ecliptic while the hour angle of the sun is measured along the equator. Even if the sun were to move uniformly along the ecliptic, but because of obliquity of the ecliptic, the equal intervals along ecliptic will not have the same equal projections on the equator. This can be seen in the picture where the projections of equal segments, which is marked in red, along the ecliptic on the equator are not equal. Therefore, the projection of the motion of sun along the equator is non-uniform. As a result, the hour angle of the sun does not progress uniformly and the solar day is not of constant length during the year. This effect of obliquity is more pronounced near the solstice than near the equinoxes. We have just seen that the length of the day is not same. Therefore, in order to have a uniform length of solar day, a fictitious mean sun is introduced. The mean sun moves in a circular orbit around the earth and not in elliptic orbit. This takes care of the variation due to ellipticity. The mean sun moves in the plane of the equator, completing one orbit in the same time as the actual sun does while moving along the ecliptic. This takes care of the problem due to obliquity of the ecliptic. Thus, the hour angle of the mean sun progresses uniformly and the mean solar day has constant length. The time derived from the mean sun is called the mean solar time. The time interval between successive transits seen over the same meridian is defined as mean solar day. By international agreement, the time of the Greenwich meridian is called the Greenwich mean time. This can be related to the mean time of any other place through the longitude of that place. This mean solar time is the time which is shown in our clocks and watches.
The equation of time. The difference between mean solar time and the actual solar time is called as the equation of time. The equation of time is shown by the red line. The two factors contributing to it are the eccentricity of the Earth's orbit, which is a dot dashed curve, and the obliquity of the ecliptic plane to the equatorial plane, shown as a dashed curve. In the picture are also shown the vernal and the autumn equinoxes, where the effect of obliquity is zero. Therefore, at these two points, ecliptic is parallel to Earth's equator. Points A and P denote the aphelion and perihelion. Aphelion is the farthest point from the sun, and aphelion is the nearest point from the sun. The red line shows the number of minutes by which the apparent solar time or the sundial time differs from the mean solar time. On 1st of January, for example, the apparent solar time is 4 minutes behind the mean solar time. That means that 4 minutes to be added to the time given by this sundials to bring it in agreement with the mean solar time.
A spinning top not only rotates on its axis, but its axis also rotates. This rotation of axis is called as precession. The Earth is not a perfect sphere. It has a slight bulge at the equator. The gravitational field of the Sun, Moon, and to much lesser extent the planets around causes the Earth to precess. The axis of Earth describes a cone around the line perpendicular to the plane of the ecliptic. The direction of precession is clockwise if we look down on the Earth from the north. One circle of precession is completed in about 26,000 years. This astronomical precession has very important consequences. Because of this precession, the axis of Earth does not point in a fixed direction. At present, axis points towards the Polaris, which is at present our pole star. In a few thousand years, Polaris will no longer be our pole star. The second consequence of this precession is that the vernal equinox, which is the reference point in equatorial system, will also shift eastwards. Therefore, the precession of Earth will cause precession of equinoxes, and hence an important consequence for astronomy is it that it gradually changes the equatorial coordinates of celestial objects. The gravitational forces of Sun and Moon on Earth are varying, giving rise to tides. Since the forces of these tidal forces are changing their location continuously with respect to each other as well as with respect to Earth, this effect produces wobbling motion on the axis of Earth. This motion is called as nutation. Nutational motion is a cyclic motion of period around 19 years. We have seen that the precession causes shift in vernal equinox. Therefore, the vernal equinox will not occur on 21st of March every year because of this precession. The drift of vernal equinox due to precession is not very uniform. Nutation adds to this non-uniformity. The figure shows the day of occurrence of vernal equinox. The curve has been smoothed over a period of 4 years to remove small-scale irregularities. Due to the precession, the tip of Earth's axis describes a circle in the space with a period of about 26,000 years, which is shown in the picture. So it wanders among stars. The precession implies that Polaris will no longer be our pole star after a few thousand years. About 4,000 years ago, star Thuban was our pole star. In about 12,000 years, star Vega will become our pole star. The drift of vernal equinox due to the precession of Earth causes change in the equatorial coordinates of celestial objects. This also causes drift in the zodiacs. 2,000 years ago, The vernal equinox occurred when the sun entered the constellation of Aries. That is why vernal equinox is also called the first sign of Aries. At present, however, the vernal equinox occurs at the time when the sun is in constellation Pisces. In the picture, suppose green dot is the pole of the equator and the corresponding vernal equinox is at first sign of Aries. Due to the precession, the pole of the equator shifts to the position of red dot. The circle of precession is also shown as dashed curve. Also, the shifted equator is shown as green dashed arc. Corresponding to the new pole, which is represented as red dot, the vernal equinox is now at first sign of Aries with a prime. This shift of vernal equinox changes the equatorial coordinates because this vernal equinox is the reference point in the equatorial system, which is used for making star catalogs.
Part taken by the point of vernal equinox along the ecliptic over the past 6,000 years are shown in the picture. About 2,000 years back, the sun was in the zodiac constellation Aries at the time of vernal equinox. Due to the precession of the earth, the sun today is in the constellation Pisces at the time of vernal equinox. As a result, the zodiac signs are no longer in step with the constellations from which they derive their names.
Let us consider a point X on the earth's surface in the picture taken at the time of vernal equinox. In this situation, the earth is at position even. Both the sun or any distant star are overhead. After one rotation of earth about its axis, earth is in position E2. The distant star is again overhead of X. Therefore, according to a distant star, one day has been completed. This day is called as a sidereal day. When sun will be overhead of X, then one solar day will be completed. One solar day will be completed when X moves to position Y, as shown in the picture. The angle XO prime Y is about 1 degree. Therefore, Earth has to undergo an additional rotation of 1 degree to complete one solar day. We know in 24 hours, Earth rotates by 360 degrees. This implies in 1 degree, Earth rotates by 1/15th of an hour, which is 4 minutes. This means that the solar day is longer than a sidereal day by 4 minutes. A solar day lasts for 24 hours and a sidereal day lasts for 23 hours 56 minutes. Sidereal time is the time measured with respect to distant stars. We know that the stars move around the earth in diurnal circles parallel to the equator. They appear on observer's meridian at same instant. Then their hour angle progresses steadily. Instead of any distant star, we can also take vernal equinox as our reference point. Because of precession of Earth's axis and nutational motion, the vernal equinox is also precessing. Therefore, a mean vernal equinox is defined much like the way mean sun is defined. Mean vernal equinox is supposed to move uniformly along the celestial equator.
So students, let us summarize what we have learned in this module. Interval between two successive passages of sun over the observer's meridian defines a solar day. Length of a solar day is not constant. The two reasons are, first, variation in the speed of Earth in its ecliptic path around the sun, and second, the obliquity of the plane of the ecliptic to the celestial equator. To overcome these problems, a mean sun is imagined traveling along the equator at a uniform speed. Mean solar time is defined by the mean sun. Our clocks and watches keep the mean solar time. The difference between the mean solar time and the apparent solar time is given by the equation of time. Sidereal time is defined as the interval between two successive passages of the vernal equinox over the observer's meridian. Vernal equinox is not a fixed point in the sky. It drifts irregularly due to the precession and nutation of the Earth. Precession of the Earth is caused by the inclination of its axis of rotation to the plane of the ecliptic. Precession has three major effects. It makes the sidereal year shorter than the tropical year. It changes the equatorial coordinates of the celestial objects. And it causes a slow apparent drift in the zodiac constellations. Sidereal day is shorter than the solar day by 4 minutes. Therefore, every day a star rises 4 minutes earlier than the previous day. Similarly, a star sets 4 minutes earlier than the previous day. Early rising and setting of stars than the previous day causes the sky to change slowly every night. The effect is apparent over a time of a few weeks. Local mean time, also called as LMT, is defined as hour angle of the mean sun plus 12 hours. Local mean time of various places is coordinated by the local mean time of Greenwich, which is called the universal time. Standard and zone times are defined with respect to the universal time. Thank you.